Hi, I'm Dr. Bhargavi. I'm an associate professor in the Department of Management Studies in Bharat University. In today's session, we'll be seeing the different concepts of organizational behavior. Let us start with the meaning of organization. What is an organization? We know that organization is going to be a group of people who come together to achieve a common purpose. So these group of people, they have a common goal and there are established standards for them to achieve. So Dessler has given this definition for organization, stating that an organization consists of people who carry out different tasks which contribute to their organization's goals. Now, apart from organization, what is organizing? Organizing can be a process that identifies related activities, and then these activities are grouped so that they can be formed as tasks and they can be accomplished easily. So we have seen what is organization and what is organizing. Coming to the next slide, we have the features of organization. What are the different features of organization? First, it is a continuous process. As we all know that an organization is a place where there are activities carried out in a systematic manner. So they are planned and they are carried out. So these systematic activities take place in a continuous manner. So there is a layout of plan behind, and these activities are carried on continuously. Then the second point says that there are structure of relationships. We all know that in an organization, there are hierarchies existing. So these hierarchies talk about the structure or the formal structure of an organization. So there may be a top level management, there may be a middle level management, there may be a lower level management. So there are different structures prevailing in an organization. Third point is common purpose. So what is common purpose? We saw that organization is a group of people. So many people come together and they start their work in a workplace. Now these people will have one common goal laid down by the top management. So they all work for a common purpose, which can be to achieve the organizational objectives. Then the next one is division of work. So these group of members who come together are given separate tasks by their managers. So each one of them have some tasks and responsibilities to be carried out. So division of work takes place among themselves. Then the next point is cooperation and communication. So what do these group of people do? Without cooperation, there cannot be a harmony in workplace. So people have to ensure that there is a group cooperation taking place and there are a proper mode of communication between the members in a group. So once cooperation and communication is ensured by the group, then things will fall into place and it will be easy for them to achieve their organizational objectives. Then the last point is pooling of efforts. What does pooling of efforts mean? Pooling here means that we are assimilating. So assimilation of the efforts of people take place. So different individuals come together in a group and they work together. They put their efforts together and then they do the task assigned to them to accomplish the goals. So these are the features of an organization. Coming to the next slide, we have the meaning of behavior. So what does behavior mean? Behavior can be set of traits and actions that determine and that is going to examine the response of individuals in different situations. So how as an individual I'm going to exhibit myself in different situations I face can be called as my behavior. So people behave differently in different kind of situations. So behavior of a person at a workplace may be entirely different from his personal behavior. So the way he exhibits himself at home may be different, and the way he exhibits himself at a workplace may be different. So understanding how individuals interact with each other and carry out the given tasks to them leads to the study of organizational behavior. So the next slide talks about what is organizational behavior. So organizational behavior is a study of organizations and individuals who are working in these organizations, so that there is a proper interaction between the individual and the organization. So it helps to understand how humans behave, and it gives ways to manage this behavior of individuals effectively. So Stephen Robbins has given the definition for organization behavior. He states that organization behavior is a field of study that investigates the impact which the individuals, groups and structures have on behavior within the organization. So this can be applied for improving the organization's effectiveness. This was the definition given by Stephen Robbins. The next slide here, you can see an image. What does the image infer? We have different individuals in different postures, and we can see that these individuals exhibit different traits. They exhibit different behavior. We all know that individuals exhibit different kinds of behaviors at work. So some individuals may be very extroverts. They may have a good level of social bonding. Whereas some individuals may be very closed. They may be introverts at work. So they may not mingle much with people. And some may form groups, and they will accomplish their objectives among the group, along with the group. So here this image infers that different people exhibit different kinds of behaviors at work, and they also play different roles in the workplace. So they have to have individual responsibilities. They have to take up the organizational goals, work on them within a stipulated time. So this is the inference of the image. The next slide talks about the nature of OB. So the study of organization behavior can involve all these points stated here. The first one is rational thinking. What does rational thinking mean? What is rationality? Rationality is where you make the choices that result in optimum benefits. So rationality is induced by organizational behavior. The second point is action-orientedness. Why is it action-oriented? Because individuals are given separate goals and they put their efforts and actions to accomplish it. That's the reason why OB is action-oriented. Again, the next point is it is interdisciplinary. Why is it interdisciplinary? Because it uses concepts from different backgrounds. So it involves behavioral concepts. It involves social sciences concept. So concepts from different backgrounds are being involved in studying organizational behavior. Then the next point is it is a science and art. Why is it called as science? It is called a science because it uses practical situations to achieve results. It can be applied in real-time situations to get the results. Whereas why is it called as an art? Because OB is going to induce the creative thought process in an individual. So either be it creativity can be used to shape the perception or to study human behavior. So these concepts involve the application of art practices. So OB is both a science and art. The next point, it says that OB is goal oriented. How is OB goal oriented? See, organizational behavior is going to ensure that individuals, group and organization objectives are aligned in a specific manner and they are systematically implemented. So the end target here is to achieve the goals. So OB is a goal oriented process. The next point says that OB is pervasive. What does pervasive mean? Pervasive means it is present everywhere. So existence or universality or omnipresence. So OB is pervasive in nature. So as we all know, organizations are made up of people. So their behavior is going to influence the success or failure of an organization. So organization behavior is required in all the workplaces to influence the human behavior so that the objectives can be achieved easily. The next point is it is a systems approach. We know that an organization is made up of different systems, or there are systematic procedures and guidelines in an organization to be followed by the members who work in it. So this organization can be considered as a system containing interdependent elements. So the elements here refers to the resources who work in it. So it is a systems approach. The next slide talks about the scope of OB. What is the scope of OB? The scope of OB comprises of these four aspects. The first one is individual behavior. How does OB consist of individual behavior? Because it studies aspects like motives, attitudes, perception, personality traits, different forms of learning, how to manage stress. So everything that is concerned within an individual, within myself, so that I, me concept is studied extensively. So it is a study of individual behavior. The next point says that it comprises of group behavior. So how does it comprise of group behavior? We know that once an individual is going to enter into a workplace, then he is assigned into a group. So he forms teams so that the organizational objectives can be accomplished easily. So group behavior may include interpersonal behavior. It may include group dynamics, the intergroup conflicts, and leadership of in between groups. Then the motivation formed or given by the group members to an individual. So these concepts that happen inside a group are also being studied in organizational behavior. The next point is, it also talks about organizational structure. So as we talked in the earlier slides, we all know that there are hierarchies present in an organization. So it is like once an organization is started, then the first thing an organization does is to lay down the structure. So there can be formal structures, there can be informal structures in an organization. So the different structures prevalent in an organization are studied by OB. The last point is the vision and mission. What is vision? Vision is where an organization wants to be down the lane, say 5 years or 10 years. So where the organization perceives itself in the future. So what is the position that it wants to gain in future will be stated in the vision. Whereas mission is a roadmap. It is a plan layout of how to achieve the objectives stated in the vision statement. So mission is going to be a layout of actions so that it states how to achieve the organizational objectives. So these are the scope of organizational behavior. So if we see the importance of OB, why is OB required to be studied, then these are the points that stress the importance of OB. The first point is it strengthens perceptual skills. What does perception mean? Perception means the way in which one sees, the be it the world or himself. So if I'm going to view myself, then it can be called as self-perception, and the way I see the world can be called generically as a perception. So it strengthens perceptual skills. Why? Because OB will help a person to understand the attitudes, personality traits of others, ego states, the conflict resolution methods, the study of groups and their behaviors. So all these concepts are studied under organizational behavior. So it strengthens an individual's perceptual skills. Then second point is it emphasizes on human dignity. What is dignity? Dignity can be called as a respect given to an individual. So OB considers the abilities, skills and talents of individuals. So it gives importance to the respect and it improves people through education and training. So it keeps on improvising the human behavior. So it emphasizes human dignity. Then the third point is it avoids and resolves conflicts. Why do conflicts arise? Conflicts arise when there are difference of opinions or when there are clash of thoughts between individuals. So conflicts arise because of psychological reasons. So what OB does? OB helps to understand human behavior through psychological concepts. So it tries to avoid and resolve the conflicts. Then the fourth point is it enables to adapt to changes. We all know that organizations face change continuously. So nothing is permanent. We all know that change happens in some point of time or the other. So organizations need to adapt the changes in order to survive and grow on. So organizational behavior can play a very important role in minimizing this resistance to change within individuals, and it can help them to be more flexible. So that is maximizing the flexibility and minimizing the resistance to change. The next point is it maximizes employees' potential. What OB does? OB stresses on understanding individual needs and providing suitable motivation for individuals to perform their best, so to improve their performance. So it recognizes the talents which an individual has and it gives ways to enlarge the potentials present inside an individual. The next point is it enables to achieve organizational goals. OB helps a manager to understand the individual and the group actions so that he can devise ways to improve their effectiveness. So once managers understand how an individual behaves and how do they behave in groups, he'll be able to get an idea of what can be done to improve their effectiveness more and more. So it enables to achieve organizational goals. Then the next point is it enhances healthy relations. We all know that OB is a study of human behavior. So it gives an understanding of interpersonal relationships. So this can be done through the study of attitudes or the study of group dynamics or the study of transactional analysis. So these studies can help to understand interpersonal relationships and maintain healthy relationships in a workplace. Then the last point is it improves organizational climate. What is an organizational climate? What does climate generally mean? Climate means the weather or how is the surrounding, how is the ambience. So in an organizational concept, we see how is a workplace, What is the ambience of a workplace? If there is going to be a very positive surrounding, then the employees may be highly energetic. They'll do things very fast. They'll be always cheerful. Whereas in a negative environment or in a very negative surrounding, employees may not tend to react much to things that come their way. They will be very closed in nature. So it may affect their performance. So organizational climate is required, a good organizational climate is required for a better performance of an employee. So good organizational climate can not be only created through monetary benefits, whereas it also needs open communication or a very healthy relationship between workers and in having the suggestions of workers while taking decisions. So all these will also improve the positive surrounding in a workplace. So it improves organizational climate. The next slide talks about the process of OB. So what does OB consist of? What are the activities that take place in OB? We have around 6 steps involved in the process of OB. The first step is analyzing behavior. So what happens in the analysis of behavior? The first step in the OB process is to assess employees' behavior. So employees' behavior can be assessed in 3 different levels. So the first level can be individual level, where the various aspects of individuality are studied by the managers. So individuality concepts may include perception, it may include attitudes, it may include learning, it may include motivation. So individual aspects are first studied. The second one is group level. So the second level of analyzing a behavior can be a group level. So how an individual reacts when he is put in a group. So or how does he communicate when he is placed inside a group. So at the group level, the concepts analyzed can be leadership qualities, the communication between group members, the group's moral and ethics, then the power and politics played by different group members, then their conflicts that raise inside a group, their resolution measures. So all these concepts are studied under a group level. Then the third level of analyzing a human behavior can be at the organization's level. So what happens in organization's level? What are the concepts that are studied under organizational level? You can see that every organization has a set of values. Every organization has an organization culture. So these concepts like values, the beliefs of the organization, the organization's culture, the change that takes place inside an organization, all these can be studied under organization's level. So analysis of behavior takes place in 3 levels. The first one is individual level, second one is group level, and the third one, it is at organization's level. Now, the second step is understanding behavior. So, what happens here? So, once the analysis of behavior is over, the next step is the behavior is tried to be understood. So, it is tried to be inferred. So, this step involves studying the factors that influence the behavior. So, based on this understanding, the individual behavior steps are taken. So behavior is understood. Then the third one is prediction of behavior. What happens here? Once the manager tries to analyze the behavior and understand the behavior, then he tries to predict or forecast what will be the reaction of an employee when he is given this particular task. So the behavior is forecasted. So as a manager, I'm trying to predict the behavior of my subordinate when he is put under certain work conditions. So behavior prediction happens. Then the next step is where control of behavior takes place. So what happens in control of behavior? For example, let us take 2 situations. First one is a positive situation, the second one is a negative situation. Under a positive situation, let us say as a manager, I assign my subordinate with moderate level of work. Now, what happens is my subordinate is a very positive person. He is an optimistic person. So he devises a time frame. He lays down a plan of action and tries to finish the work I assign him within the stipulated time. So this will result in a positive outcome. Whereas in a negative situation, let us say my subordinate is a very pessimistic person. He doesn't likes to go and mingle around or take things seriously. Let us say he's a very pessimistic person. In that case, what will happen is when I assign the same level of moderate work to this pessimistic subordinate, he will not be able to complete the work within this stipulated time. So what will that result in? It will result in a negative consequence or a negative outcome. So as a manager, I'll be able to understand what are the behavioral outcomes of individuals. So whether my subordinate will behave in a positive manner or in a negative manner. So once I start to get that understanding, I will try to control the behavior of my subordinates. That is what this step means. The next one is organizational effectiveness. So what is organizational effectiveness? Every organization should have the right number of people, the right kind of people at the right place and the right time. So if there are not these things involved in the organization, then that will lead to either disputes, or there may not be harmony in the workplace, or there may not be much of an organizational effectiveness. So in this stage, what happens is that the objective of OB is to improve the organizational effectiveness. So the steps taken to achieve organizational effectiveness are studied, and if these steps are not going to be in the right path, then suitable changes are given and they are implemented in the organization to get more or high level of organization's effectiveness. Then the last step is feedback. What happens in this feedback? This is the final stage of the process of OB. So what happens in this feedback stage is that information about objectives, information about the results, deviations are obtained by the managers and corrective actions are taken. So once, if an individual is going to follow all the rules and he's going to follow all the procedures, that will result in a positive outcome. So he may have a good feedback. Whereas a pessimistic person who doesn't follow rules, who always has a deviation from the rule, then he will have face a negative situation. So in that case, corrective actions have to be taken for bringing this pessimistic person back into the same positive mindset. So this is the last step in the feedback, which is the last step in the process of OB. So process of OB consists of analyzing behavior, understanding behavior, prediction of behavior, control of behavior, organization's effectiveness, feedback. Now, once this feedback is given by the managers, then if the feedback is going to be good, then that is going to lead to a analysis of behavior, and the proper strategies will be devised to have a good behavior by an individual at work. So with this, the process of OB gets over and we move on to the role of managers in an organization. Under the role of managers, we have three categories of roles played by managers. So the first category is an interpersonal role. The second category is an informational role. The third category is decisional role. Now, if we see interpersonal roles, what do interpersonal relationships mean? Interpersonal relationships mean the harmony or the bonding between two individuals. So if I'm going to have a good relationship with my colleagues, then I have a strong interpersonal relationship. So these interpersonal roles again have three sub classifications. So a manager as and interpersonal role plays these three classifications. The first one is he plays a role of a figurehead. What does figurehead mean? Figurehead is where a manager not only does the work of supervision, he steps in, motivates the employee and boosts up his confidence so that the employee or his subordinate is also able to work and achieve better. So he plays more like a role model to a employee. The second is a leader. Who is a leader or what is leadership? We all know that leadership is the ability to influence a group of people to achieve a common goal. So a leader here is going to attract a group of followers and motivate them to accomplish the organizational objectives. Then the third one in the interpersonal role is the role of a liaison. So who is a liaison? A liaison can be a mediator, he can be an agent. So someone who's going to act as a close link between the top management and the lower level management. So he is going to enable the flow of information in an organization. So a manager plays these three interpersonal roles. The first one as a figurehead, the second one as a leader, and the third one as a liaison. Now, the second role played by a manager is going to be that of an informational role. So, what do informational roles mean? That a manager is going to be responsible for collecting information and disseminating this information to different groups of people. So, informational role has three categories again. The first one is monitor, the second one is disseminator, and the third one is spokesperson. So, under monitor, what does a manager do? He's going to only collect information from different parties. So, be it his subordinate or be it his top management or from different sides, he's going to collect information and keep it with them. Now, the second role played under information category is a disseminator. So, as you all know, what is dissemination? Dissemination means you are going to distribute. So, you are going to give the information in your hand to different parties. So, as a disseminator, he distributes the information which he has and pass it on to the different groups involved with the organization. So he plays a role of a disseminator. Now, the third category under informational role is a spokesperson. Now, who is a spokesperson? We would have heard this term spokesperson earlier. Now, a spokesperson is someone who's going to represent one party to the other party. So, a manager, for example, let us take a generic example that I work in an organization as a manager. Now, as a spokesperson, I will represent my organization and speak on the behalf of my organization to the other person. So, I am playing the role of a spokesperson. So, these are the three categories that fall under the informational role. Now, the third category here under the main role is a decisional role. So, what happens on a decisional role? Managers again play three more different roles under a decisional role. The first part he plays is that of an entrepreneur. The second one as a disturbance handler and third one as a resource allocator. Now, in a decisional role, an entrepreneur is who? Any person who is going to take a risk. So, a manager is going to take a risk and he is going to take a decision based on the inference he has, and it is going to involve some amount of risk. So, a manager plays the role of an entrepreneur by taking risky decisions in an organization. Then the second one is a disturbance handler. What is a disturbance handler going to do? For example, if there are going to be different groups involved in an organization, then a manager is going to act as a disturbance handler in dealing with conflicts between different individuals. So if there's going to be a clash of thought or a difference opinion, then a manager is going to step in and he's going to act as a conflict resolving person. So he's going to act as a disturbance handler. The third role under the category of decision is a resource allocator. So what does a manager do under a resource allocator? He is going to allot different resources to different category of individuals. For example, I am a manager who is going to belong to a top level management, then I will assign what are the resources needed by my lower level management people to the different groups involved in the lower level management. So I'm going to allocate specific resources to specific people. So these are the different roles played by managers in an organization. So with this, we come to the end of today's session. Thank you. Thank you for listening.